Good morning to you. It's 7:01 here on the East Coast. I'm Laura Podesta. Anne Marie is off today. Breaking overnight, we are monitoring news of attacks on the U.S. military base in Somalia. Officials say a suicide car bomber detonated explosives at the gate of a military airstrip used by the U.S. and Somali forces. Somalia's Islamic extremist group Al-Shabaab has claimed responsibility for the attack. There was also a separate attack on a European military convoy in the Somali capital. It's not yet known if there are any casualties. So this is a developing situation, and we'll continue to bring you more information as we have it. So now let's go to Washington, where the impeachment inquiry into President Trump is expected to move forward this morning. More subpoenas could come in as early as today. On last night's 60 Minutes, House Intelligence Chairman Adam Schiff told Scott Pelley the committee plans to subpoena the president's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani. Schiff also told Pelley that the committee reached an agreement that allows the whistleblower to testify. But lawyers for the whistleblower disputed those claims, saying that discussions with Congress continue and no date or time has been set. 60 Minutes also obtained a letter that indicates the whistleblower who set off this whole impeachment inquiry is under federal protection because of fears for their safety. So here's part of Pelley's interview with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy.
We could not ignore what the president did. He gave us no choice. So it wasn't any change of mind. I always said, we will follow the facts where they take us. And when we see them, we will be ready, and we are ready.
Your Republican colleagues say, well, the call is the call, but there's nothing here that rises to the level of high crimes and misdemeanors.
Well, they're wrong. And it remains to be seen, because it's not just what happens in the call. It's part of the sequencing of events as well. You withdraw a couple $100 million worth of assistance to a country, and then a couple of days later say, by the way, can you help me with my campaign, in other words. There's a sequencing there.
How do you expect the president's defense to roll out going forward?
The defense of what?
Well, there's an impeachment inquiry.
Yeah. There's an impeachment inquiry going forward. It probably never would move forward had the speaker waited 48 hours to have the transcript. We vote on important things every day, but there are certain votes that are different than others. Sending men and women off to war is the most difficult vote any member of Congress would ever make.
I'll ask you again, how does the defense of the president, in your view, roll out from here?
Why would we move forward with impeachment? There's not something that you have to defend here.
You say the president has done nothing wrong. I take that to mean that you find it appropriate that the president asked Mr. Zelensky for an investigation of his Democratic rivals.
The question before the House of Representatives is to impeach the president based upon a phone call that the speaker never even heard.
Well, the president has been tweeting over the weekend, including paraphrasing a quote from a conservative pastor where he predicts civil war if impeachment goes forward, saying, quote, it will cause a civil war-like fracture in this nation. So as the impeachment inquiry intensifies, a majority of Americans approve of what Congress is doing. CBS News is out with a new poll that shows 55% of Americans support the impeachment inquiry. And when you break it down by party, the split is predictable. 77% of Republicans disapprove, 87% of Democrats approve. And independents are split just about 50-50. Our elections director will have a lot more insight into the numbers in our 9 a.m. hour. But for now, let's turn to Mark Liverman. So, Mark, Congress is on a two-week recess. What does that mean for these impeachment inquiry proceedings?
Well, both depositions and hearings, they're scheduled for this week. This is the Trump administration continued to question the whistleblower's motives.
House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff told 60 Minutes the whistleblower complaint is a roadmap for the impeachment inquiry.
Your committee already has an agreement with the whistleblower that he will testify.
We have an agreement that he or she will testify, yes.
Schiff says that'll happen very soon and in a way that protects his or her identity. The whistleblower's attorney says no agreement with Congress has been reached.
The spies and treason We used to handle it a little differently than we do now.
Those comments by President Trump last week prompted the whistleblower's lawyers to send a letter to the acting director of National Intelligence, noting that certain individuals are offering a $50,000 bounty for their client's identity. Tweeting throughout the day Sunday, the president said he deserves to meet his accuser and warned of big consequences. The whistleblower's complaint alleges President Trump pressured Ukraine's president to investigate Joe Biden and his son Hunter. It also says that White House officials sought to lock down the transcript.
This is a deep state operative.
The president's advisors and Republican allies attacked the whistleblower on Sunday.
I can't believe we're talking about impeaching the president based on an accusation based on hearsay.
Democrats argue there is serious evidence of wrongdoing.
Caught red-handed trying to solicit foreign interference in the 2020 election.
A new CBS News poll found the majority of Americans approve of Congress opening the impeachment inquiry.
So, Mark, what else can you tell us about the CBS News poll?
So the poll also found that the majority of Americans are divided when it comes to whether President Trump should be impeached over Ukraine, with the majority of Republicans backing the president.
So pretty much split. As far as Democrats who were polled, what did they say about what happens next?
So most Democrats say they're glad this impeachment inquiry is already underway at this point.
Okay, so they want these proceedings to
continue. They want
continue
them to keep going.
For people to be subpoenaed,
exactly,
et cetera, et cetera.
Exactly, exactly.
Mark Liverman, thank you so much.
Sure thing.
Joe Biden's presidential campaign is demanding major news organizations stop booking President Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani. Biden's top aides sent letters to news organizations yesterday asking them to end existing and future plans to have Giuliani on air. They say giving President Trump's personal lawyer and former New York mayor airtime allows Giuliani to, quote, introduce increasingly unhinged, unfounded, and desperate lies into the national conversation. Well, for his part, Giuliani responded on Twitter saying, quote, the Bidens are clearly rattled. He continued to tweet about the Biden campaign over the next several hours, claiming, quote, the Bidens have played the influence game for years. And as Natalie Brand reports, Rudy Giuliani is now at the center of the Biden-Ukraine probe after contradicting himself on whether or not he asked Ukrainian officials to investigate the former vice president.
What's going on now is the single greatest scam in the history of American politics.
Interviews with key figures could begin as early as this week in the impeachment inquiry centered around allegations President Trump pressured Ukraine's leader to investigate a political rival, Joe Biden and his son Hunter. According to the whistleblower complaint made public late last week, the president's personal attorney, Rudy Giuliani, was a central figure in relaying messages between Kiev and the president.
Did Secretary of State Pompeo know you were doing these things? Did he ask you to do these things?
He did not. Mr. Volker did, and then Mr. Sondland did. But when I talked to the secretary last week, he said he was aware of it.
Kurt Volker, who resigned Friday as the special envoy to Ukraine, and Gordon Sondland, the U.S. ambassador to the EU, are among the five State Department officials House Democrats would like to interview.
It was so clear that Giuliani is looking for this compromising material on Biden for Trump.
CBS's Roxana Saberi spoke to Sergei Lyshenko, a former advisor to Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky, who says Giuliani tried to set up a meeting with Zelensky just before his inauguration this past April.
Do you know why he said no?
I believe because he understood that everything is behind the story is very toxic, and he didn't want to be involved in this.
A new CBS News poll found the majority of Americans approve of Congress opening the impeachment inquiry. But Americans are divided over whether the president deserves to be impeached over Ukraine, with a majority of Republicans backing the president.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi said this weekend the inquiry is worth the political risk ahead of 2020. Some Democratic lawmakers have said they would like to take a vote on articles of impeachment by Thanksgiving, but there's no real sense of timeline since the investigation is just beginning. Natalie Brand, CBS News, The White House.
Thanks to Natalie Brand. In that piece, you heard Roxana Saberi speaking with a former advisor to the Ukrainian president. So you'll hear more of that interview when Roxana joins us live from Ukraine at the bottom of the hour. Turning now to an explosive interview on 60 Minutes last night, Saudi Arabia's de facto leader gave his first American TV interview since the murder of a Washington Post contributor at a Saudi consulate in Turkey. CBS Evening News anchor and managing editor Nora O'Donnell spoke with Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, who's believed to have ordered the murder of Jamal Khashoggi in Istanbul 1 year ago. Here's part of that interview.
Did you order the murder of Jamal Khashoggi?
Absolutely not. This was a heinous crime. But I take full responsibility as a leader in Saudi Arabia, especially since it was committed by individuals working for the Saudi government.
What does that mean, that you take responsibility?
When a crime is committed against a Saudi citizen by officials working for the Saudi government, as a leader, I must take responsibility. This was a mistake, and I must take all actions to avoid such a thing in the future.
How did you not know about this operation?
Some think that I should know what 3 million people working for the Saudi government do daily. It's impossible that the 3 million would send their daily reports to the leader or the second highest person in the Saudi government.
The CIA has concluded with medium to high confidence that you personally targeted Khashoggi and you probably ordered his death.
I hope this information to be brought forward. If there is any such information that charges me, I hope it is brought forward publicly.
What kind of threat is a newspaper columnist to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia that he would deserve to be brutally murdered?
There is no threat from any journalist. The threat to Saudi Arabia is from such actions against a Saudi journalist. This heinous crime that took place in a Saudi consulate.
And this is one of our most clicked on stories on CBSNews.com. We'll have more on reaction to the Crown Prince's response at 9:30 when Jared Malson joins us from Cairo. Jared is the Wall Street Journal's Middle East correspondent. Turning now to that massive September snowstorm in Montana, kids are waking up to a snow day after some 4 feet of snow fell on that state. Carter Evans is in Great Falls, Montana, one of the hardest hit towns.
Montana's early winter storm blasted the city of Great Falls with more than a foot of September snow that covered streets and made driving difficult.
My recommendation is to stay off the road if you can.
Sergeant Wade Palin is with the Montana Highway Patrol.
The biggest challenges are roads will freeze again, so they'll become more ice covered.
Closer to the mountains, snow measured in feet piled high outside homes, with high winds knocking down trees and at one point, thousands lost power.
When is the last time you've seen a September snow like this?
I have never seen a September snow like this.
National Weather Service meteorologist Don Britton has lived in Great Falls for more than 40 years, and he says this storm is a record breaker.
But that one set back in 1934, that was broken.
That was a three-day record of over 13 inches of snow. We've already had over 14 inches of snow in just 2 days, so that record is pretty much obliterated.
The snowstorm also hit parts of Idaho, and in Spokane, Washington, this is the first time they've recorded snow on this date since they started keeping records back in 1881. Forecasters expect the winter weather to continue.
Hunker down, stay warm, and try to avoid traveling.
The storm is expected to move out of the area. Some schools will remain closed on Monday, but all of this snow is expected to melt by the end of the week, so everyone here can get back to fall. Carter Evans, CBS News, Great Falls, Montana.
Carter Evans, thank you. And coming up after the break, protests across Hong Kong continue for the 17th straight week. We have the latest on the unending clashes between protesters and police ahead of China's 70th anniversary. And the trial of former Dallas police officer Amber Geiger is nearing its end. A judge's instructions to the jury could make a big difference. So keep it right here. You're streaming CBSN AM. And here's a look at some of the stories you may have missed while you were offline. In Dallas, a 72-year-old man is accused of killing a suspected burglar, then going back to bed for a couple of hours before calling police. James Meyer told police he heard a noise while he was sleeping. He got up. He saw someone trying to break into a storage shed. Meyer says when the alleged burglar took a few steps toward him, he started shooting into the dark. Then he went back to sleep. According to police, Meyer says he only realized the man was dead a few hours later when he went back outside and found the body. And in North Carolina, police have captured three men who broke out of jail in Ohio. One escapee is still on the run. Officials say the four escaped from the Gallia County Jail in southern Ohio after overpowering two female corrections officers and breaking down a secure door to get outside early Sunday morning. As we mentioned, one inmate is still on the run and is considered extremely dangerous. And nothing lasts forever, not even if you have forever in your name. Forever 21, the low-cost fashion chain, has filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. The privately held company says it will close up to 178 stores in the U.S., but it's not saying which ones. Forever 21 once had more than 800 stores worldwide and 500 in the U.S. Forever 21 specializes in fast fashion, but it's been under pressure lately as online shopping continues to rise. And turning back to our top story today, Democrats may deliver subpoenas to the president's lawyers as early as today. House Intelligence Chairman Adam Schiff said his committee will subpoena the president's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, for documents. Our Roxana Saberi has been digging into those communications between Rudy Giuliani, President Trump, and Ukraine's president. And she's in Kiev, the capital of Ukraine. Roxana, have you heard about any new information on the content of those talks?
Well, good morning, Laura. We heard this morning Ukraine's president saying that he will not be releasing a transcript of his July 25th phone call with President Trump. A former advisor to the Ukrainian president told us it was a, quote, well-known fact here that President Trump was looking for compromising information on Joe Biden. And Ukraine's president knew that U.S. aid to his country was at stake.
I'm sure that issue of Biden was forever on the table between Zelensky and Trump.
As a former lawmaker and advisor to Ukraine's president, Volodymyr Zelensky, Serhiy Leshenko believes it was clear that President Trump wanted Ukraine to investigate his democratic rivals.
Of course, he wanted political privileges, favors for his re-election from Ukraine.
In return for military aid?
I would say yes.
Do you have any evidence of that?
It was like well-known fact in Ukraine.
In 2016, Leshenko was at the center of exposing Paul Manafort's dealings in Ukraine. He says he recused himself from working for Zelensky in May this year after it became clear that could threaten relations with the Trump administration. Ukraine relies heavily on U.S. aid in its war against Russia. In July, Trump ordered nearly $400 million of that support withheld. Days later, in a phone call, he asked Ukraine's president to investigate the Bidens. According to the whistleblower's complaint, Mr. Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, made or attempted contact with at least seven Ukrainian officials, including then-prosecutor general Yuri Lutsenko. Lutsenko told the BBC Giuliani asked him to investigate the Bidens.
Have you got any evidence that Joe Biden acted in any way which supported Hunter Biden's company, Burisma?
It is not my jurisdiction.
Under Ukrainian law, you've got nothing.
Nothing, certainly.
But Leshenko says the two men were circumventing official channels.
So, Roxana, did that advisor give you any evidence of that, circumventing those communication channels?
Laura, he did tell us that Giuliani also tried to meet with President Zelensky before Zelensky's inauguration back in April, but that Zelensky said no because he realized everything about this story was toxic and he didn't want to get involved. Of course, he's very involved now, Laura.
Yes, exactly. Thank you so much, Roxana. And chaos continues in Hong Kong as protesters clash with police, sparking fears of more brutal encounters leading up to China's National Day. The protests, now in their third month, are expected to intensify as China celebrates its 70th anniversary of communist rule on Tuesday. Clashes between protesters and police continued over the weekend as police confirmed the arrests of more than 150 people. Remy Innocencio has been in Hong Kong overnight and has the latest developments.
This banner behind me celebrating China's 70th anniversary, along with several others throughout the city, has now been repaired after demonstrators stormed the Central Business District on Sunday. Angry demonstrators ripped down patriotic Chinese signs like this one, venting anger against Beijing and what they call is a slow erosion of their democratic freedoms. On social media, videos were posted of protesters as well as regular passengers escaping a subway station closed during the chaos. while the entrance to another was engulfed in flames sparked by Molotov cocktails. The violence between police and protesters has only escalated over the past 17 weeks. Police now using tear gas and water cannons loaded with blue-dyed liquid, a tactic used to identify protesters. All this while Beijing plans a major celebration across Tiananmen Square, where its military might and economic prowess will be on full display. But here in Hong Kong, protests are planned, and that is despite a police ban. Those could embarrass Beijing on a day it wants the world to see China as a prosperous and stable country. Vlad, Laura?
Rami, thank you so much. So let's head over to Johannesburg, South Africa, check in with foreign correspondent Deborah Patta. Deborah, more than 100 people in the past week have been hurt or injured, you tell us, from severe flooding in northern India. What do we know?
Good morning. These late monsoon rains have been unusually heavy, and they continue to batter parts of India. Houses, streets, and even hospital wards have been affected by these floods. In the Indian states of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, the floods have resulted in misery and chaos. Vehicles are almost completely submerged. Boats have heeded the call for assistance, trying to rescue people some waist deep in the gushing water. Even tractors have been used to transport families across flooded areas. Railway traffic, motorways, schools, healthcare services and the power supply in both states have also been severely disrupted. In the UK, beleaguered yet defiant British Prime Minister Boris Johnson has insisted there was no interest to declare amid a storm over his association with an American businesswoman when he was mayor of London. The Prime Minister has been referred to the police complaints body to assess whether he should face criminal prosecution over his links with former model and entrepreneur Jennifer Arcuri. Weekend newspapers reported Arcuri has told a number of friends she had an affair with Johnson. And during that time, it's alleged she was given $155,000 in public money and privileged access to three foreign trade missions led by Johnson when he was mayor. Prince Harry continues with his solo leg of the royal couple's African tour. Today he is in Malawi, highlighting wildlife conservation, an issue close to his heart. The Duke laid a wreath at the memorial site of a British guardsman who was killed by an elephant during a joint anti-poaching mission with the British Army and Malawian African banks. He also observed an anti-poaching patrol. Malawi has had some success in keeping their animals safe since they beefed up security. Last year, they seized over 2,000 pounds in ivory and made 114 arrests. Meghan remained behind in South Africa, where she's kept a low profile. The couple will meet up again here in Johannesburg tomorrow for the last 2 days of official engagements focusing on violence against women. Laura?
Thank you, Deborah. The Sikh community in Houston and around the world is mourning the loss of Sandeep Singh Dhaliwal. Dhaliwal was a sheriff's deputy in Harris County, Texas, who was shot and killed during a traffic stop on Friday. His services will take place at the Sikh National Center, where Dhaliwal was a member. Janelle Bludau had a chance to sit down with a few of those mourners.
He wore his faith like a badge of honor.
Huge loss to the family, but it's also a huge loss to the Sikh community.
Deputy Sandeep Dhaliwal brought not just security, but also a sense of pride to his Sikh community.
We won't have this jovial fellow in uniform to greet.
A community still in shock over the cruel killing of one of their own. But while Sandeep is gone, his legacy is still alive.
That you can be a proud U.S. citizen without abandoning your religious faith.
Sandeep will forever go down in history as the first Harris County Sheriff Deputy to wear a turban and beard.
He promised us that he will change departmental rules, which he did.
Dr. Hardam Singh Azad says Sandeep embodied the meaning of the Sikh religion, a beacon of faith, an advocate of diversity, but most of all, a protector of all people.
Blacks, whites, Hispanics, Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, all of them. Message is the same. We are humans first.
The deputy, loved by all communities, will be a loss we can't replace.
He's gone, but he will live in our hearts and we'll remember him.
Dr. Azad says Sikhism is a religion that's sometimes mistaken or misunderstood, and the best way you can honor Sandeep's life to remember it.
When you see a Sikh, remember the image of Sandeep Dhaliwal. Most Sikhs are his image.
Standing for Houston, Janelle Blita, KHOU 11 News.
And coming up after the break, the search for answers in an international murder mystery. Did the de facto leader of Saudi Arabia order the death of Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi? CBS Evening News anchor Nora O'Donnell goes one-on-one with the Saudi crown prince. So keep it right here. You're streaming CBSN AM. Well, a year after the murder of Washington Post journalist Jamal Khashoggi, Saudi Arabia's crown prince is taking responsibility on behalf of his government, but he denies ordering the murder. CBS Evening News anchor and managing editor Nora O'Donnell spoke to Mohammed bin Salman about how the leader was unaware of the murder operation that may have been orchestrated by people close to him.
How did you not know about this operation?
Some think that I should know what 3 million people working for the Saudi government do daily. It's impossible that the 3 million would send their daily reports to the leader or the second highest person in the Saudi government.
Jared Moulton is a Middle East correspondent for The Wall Street Journal, and he joins me now from Cairo. So is it at all surprising that Mohammed bin Salman has decided to go on camera now about this murder? Like, why is he speaking out a year later?
Yes, well, it's surprising in the sense that it's the first time he's spoken about this on camera, as you said. What is difficult to parse from what he said is that he's claiming that he had no knowledge of the operation to kill Jamal Khashoggi in the consulate in Istanbul, in spite of the fact that the man who was his top aide, his right-hand man, Saud al-Qahtani, was sanctioned by the United States over the murder, and he was also fired from his role in the royal court. And other senior intelligence and security officials from Saudi Arabia are actually on trial in Saudi Arabia's own investigation of this case. And yet he's saying that he had no knowledge of this, and this was just some of the 3 million employees of the Saudi government. Why is he saying this now? I think it's because Saudi Arabia and the Saudi government are really trying to turn a page on this incident that really shattered Mohammed bin Salman's image in the sort of court of global public opinion, that caused a backlash in the United States Congress. And they really want to turn the attention back onto the reforms that Saudi Arabia is making at home and the Crown Prince's agenda in general.
Yeah, so we'll have to see in coming days and weeks if this actually does change the conversation. In June, we know the UN recommended further investigations into what exactly the Crown Prince's role in this murder was. So what are officials in Turkey, where the murder was committed, saying? Are they cooperating?
That's right. Today, the Turkish president, Recep Tayyip Erdogan, came out and said they're still determined to get to the bottom of this murder, pointing out also that the body of Jamal Khashoggi still hasn't been recovered, really taking another criticizing the Saudi government once again over this. So it seems that they're determined not to let go of this. And I think investigators in the U.S., members of Congress who have been looking at this in the past, I don't think they're going to let go of this either. Again, this is a man who was a resident of the United States, a columnist for The Washington Post, and an interlocutor for other journalists, for policymakers. And it's not something that is going to fade away easily for the Saudi government.
And what about the Saudi government? How are they reacting to those investigations in Turkey and elsewhere?
Well, what they'll tell you and what the Crown Prince said in that interview is that they have their own investigation, they have their own trial. There are these 11 Saudi officials who are on trial in this secretive court proceeding that's happening in Saudi Arabia. We have very little insight into what's happening, even though there are diplomats from other countries, including the five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council and Turkey, who are observing this. But they've been sworn not to tell anyone what's actually happening inside the courtroom. So it's a very opaque proceeding that's happening. And what we do know is that there's been a lot of tension between the United States government and the Saudis over the fact that the senior advisors to the Crown Prince and himself seem to have avoided accountability for this killing.
Jared, before you go, I also want to ask about a recent announcement from the Saudi kingdom. We know the country unveiled a new one-year multiple entry tourist visa program that applies to visitors from 49 countries. So what exactly is this program and what prompted this move?
That's right. So Saudi Arabia unveiled a new tourist visa program for 49 countries, including Europe, United States, Canada, China, and several other countries. And this is new. This is part of this whole set of reforms that Mohammed bin Salman has put in place, where he's trying to open up the Saudi economy, diversify it, make it less dependent on oil. And it is new. In the past, if you want to visit Saudi Arabia, usually you are someone who's going on Hajj, on the pilgrimage to Mecca, or you are a business visitor, or maybe you are a resident there for some other reason, for diplomacy or some other reason. But this is brand new, but it's still unclear how this is going to go. Saudi Arabia isn't exactly a known destination for tourists from the West anyway, in the sense that alcohol is still forbidden in most cases. It isn't really set up for beach resort tourism or anything like that. So we really still have to see how this goes, especially in a context when this is torturing them and still has these unanswered questions about the Khashoggi killing.
We will see if it has a booming tourist industry. We know it has a lot of culture and history, religious history, as you mentioned. Jared Molson, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Two people are dead and two more injured when a roller coaster car flipped over in the middle of a ride in Mexico City. It happened over the weekend at an amusement park. Officials say the two who died were men ages 18 and 21. And preliminary investigations show a mechanical failure caused the car to come loose and fall from about 33 feet. Authorities are treating the incident as a case of negligent homicide. The trial of a former Dallas police officer accused of killing her neighbor is entering a critical day. Amber Geiger is on trial for killing her neighbor, Botham John, in his apartment last September. Omar Villafranca has been following this case for us, and he's at the Frank Crowley Courthouse in Dallas.
I am just in awe of what we're seeing today.
Sunday night in Dallas was the official U.S. launch of the Botham John Foundation. It was a formal red tie and red carpet fundraising gala and birthday celebration for the young man with a promising future.
I think it's a demonstration of transition of pain that we're going through into power.
The red tie event comes just 2 days after former Dallas police officer Amber Geiger testified she killed John in self-defense, mistakenly thinking he was a burglar in her apartment.
I pulled my gun out and I yelled at him. It's like, let me see your hands, let me see your hands.
Last September, Geiger told investigators she entered the wrong level of their apartment complex and walked into John's unlocked door thinking it was her own.
I never wanted to take an innocent person's life.
When you pulled that trigger, you intended to kill Mr. John.
He was the threat, yes, sir.
Early Wiley is a former judge and district attorney in Kaufman County, just outside of Dallas. She says, based on the evidence, she believes the jury will have a difficult time finding Geiger guilty of murder.
I don't know how you could ever explain a mistake like that, how you could ever live with that. But is she criminally guilty? From my training experience, she may not be.
No matter what the outcome is, we will still continue to honor him and to continue his legacy.
All right, so we're going to take a quick break. But before we do, now is probably a good time to remind you to download the free CBS News app on all your devices so you can stream us on your platform of choice. You can also watch your local news and favorite shows by subscribing to CBS All Access. We'll be right back. In Arkansas, civic leaders and community members came together to dedicate the Elaine Massacre Memorial to honor those lost in one of the deadliest racial conflicts in the state. Mercedes McKay is there with the latest.
It was a new beginning for this community. Several speakers came up and gave their message, and all of them had a similar theme.
Hopefully it means healing for this community.
This week marks 100 years of a painful part of Arkansas's history.
We don't want to not talk about what happened here.
The massacre of hundreds of black Arkansans on the Delta farmland.
It was a mystery to some degree on how many people were murdered that night. How did it start? What were the ramifications of it?
Despite the wonders of what took place in 1919, Sunday was all about forgiveness.
No anger, no recriminations, none of that. It's meant just for us to come together and finally move forward as a community.
Coming together to discuss an event that was kept silent for so many years.
I have so many friends here whose family members were on the other side. We never talk about it.
This piece of rock sparking those conversations for Brian Miller, whose four great uncles were killed in the Elaine Massacre.
We're not going to relive the past. We're going to recognize the past and recognize what our family members have done, and we're going to work together.
This new memorial representing a grave for all of those people who were never found.
Although this memorial does not have individual names on it, it's essentially that memorial for my great uncles.
Marking a new beginning for Phillips County.
You have to understand your history in order to not repeat it and learn from it and build a better society.
This memorial starts the healing process and starts the forgiveness.
It is 7:48. Time now to check in with CTM co-host Tony DeCopel to find out what's coming up on CBS This Morning.
Hey, good morning, Laura. Ahead, President Trump says he wants to meet the whistleblower whose complaint helped launch the impeachment inquiry. We'll tell you why the whistleblower's lawyers now say they're worried about their client's safety. And the Saudi crown prince tells 60 Minutes he did not order the murder of Washington Post contributor Jamal Khashoggi, but he still says he'll take full responsibility for Khashoggi's death. Plus, what's in your CBD oil? The products are exploding in popularity, but there is no widespread federal oversight. So we teamed up with a laboratory to test samples from around the country to find out. It's not just CBD. See you at 8 Eastern on CBSN.
All right, Tony, looking forward to it. See you in a few minutes. And here are some of the other stories we think people will be talking about today. The movie telling the story of the Thai boys who spent over a week stuck in a cave is premiering at a film festival. You'll remember their story. It captivated the world back in June and July of 2018. They went into the cave with their soccer coach when all of a sudden rushing flood water trapped them for 9 nights before they were found. The first movie to be made about the subject will be showing this weekend in South Korea. And we are hearing from the director of the film that it will give you a sense of claustrophobia if you check it out. So should be interesting. Over the weekend, Kanye West, Jesus is King Sunday service made a stop in Queens, New York. And there he spit rhymes of gospel. Take a look. The rapper put on his weekly service in Queens, New York at the Greater Allen AME Cathedral ahead of his latest album drop. And we hear that he is going to be giving up secular music and only doing gospel from now on. You know what? That's okay, because Jesus Walks is one of my favorite Kanye West songs. And hey, it's secular, but it had some gospel flavor to it. I I'm pro Kanye going gospel. American track and field star Allyson Felix has broken Usain Bolt's record for most gold medals in world championship history. Felix now holds 12 gold medals. She holds the record for most gold medals at Worlds. This is also her first gold medal as a mom less than a year after giving birth. She actually gave birth on November 28th via emergency C-section. So good for her to get back out there and start winning again. Millions of people around the world have come together to protest against and bring awareness to climate change in the days leading up to the UN's climate summit. According to an article from Vice, the mass protests disrupting the everyday functions of cities around the globe may be the result of the era of polite climate activism coming to an end. So we are going to bring in Billy Murray. He is a professor at Villanova. So, Billy, why are unplanned protests or protests that don't necessarily follow traditional rules so effective?
Well, I think the main purpose of a protest in any kind of movement is to disrupt a space, to disrupt people's taken-for-granted assumptions. And so what a lot of these kinds of climate marches are doing, calling for climate justice, they're disrupting what we understand to be activism, how we understand how young people engage with our system, and how we are dealing with the climate crisis.
Are we seeing any kind of momentum in recent climate protests? Are they getting, less polite and more active?
I don't know that protest is ever considered polite. I find that an interesting term, to be polite, right? People often don't think about protest that way because protest's very purpose is to not really be polite. It's to sort of make you think about things, to disrupt everything that you're sort of thinking about an issue. And so what I see from these young people doing these amazing things is not really a move away from politeness, but a move towards a real activism that actually has the ability to make some real change.
So in that same vein, Billy, will you give our viewers some context on the history of climate change protests and how they've changed over the years?
So, I mean, climate change protests for environmental conservation, they've been going on for decades, right? This isn't anything particularly new. What I think is really interesting about how they've changed in terms of the way we talk about it, the terms of our history, is that a lot of these young people, you will hear them talking about climate justice. And the environmental justice movement is also decades old, but you don't really hear those things coming together a lot in our history. And so what you see now is a push towards climate conservation and climate justice, to talk about how environmental policies adversely affect people of color, people in low economic status, these kinds of things. And what I see that I think is really powerful for these movements is that they're coming together in solidarity and seeing how all of these things interconnect: issues of justice, issues of racial justice, issues of labor and class, and really tying those things together with what has more traditionally been a conservation type of movement.
Do these protests work most of the time? What has been their impact on policy changes?
I think it depends. I think people are really quick to dismiss protest. I think people are really quick to say, oh, this doesn't matter, politicians aren't listening. And what I think is interesting is you have to think about protest as part of a much larger sort of activism. It's not that these people are just out in the streets disrupting. It's not just these young women giving speeches at the UN. It's all of these things together. It's all of the people on the ground. It's scientists doing the work and disseminating that information. It's, the justifiable outrage that they're trying to demonstrate in these protests, along with working with policymakers to make change. So all of those things really work together. So it's really important to understand protest as part of a much larger activism that's happening, a much larger movement that has a lot of interrelated parts.
And what's so interesting right now about all of these climate protests and movements is that they are being led by young adults and by teenagers. What do you think about that and that impact?
I think it's great. I think we've seen so much from these, and particularly young women and also young women of color. And this is nothing new within environmental justice movements. Mary Kopeny in Flint, Michigan, Isra Hirsi, Autumn Patellier, who's an indigenous activist, all under voting age. all over the world, right? In addition to Greta Thunberg, like these young women have been doing this and really putting themselves out there and trying to disrupt not just how we understand climate change and climate justice, but how we think about young people. We're really quick to dismiss young people, right? Oh, they don't care about anything but themselves. They're not interested in these things. They're showing us that's not true. They're showing us that they do care and that they want to be involved. And I think it's a great moment for them.
Billy Murray, thank you so much.
Thank you, Laura.
And on that happy note, if you're heading out the door, take us with you. You can stream us anytime, anywhere at cbsnews.com or on the free CBS News app. CBS This Morning is next. You've been streaming CBSN.